The name of the show is The Way to Go. My name is Alan Bendich. I'm going to be your host. Tonight we have a special guest. I've known him for years, but we've never really connected that much, and I'm happy we're connecting today. He's an excellent screenwriter. He's a producer. He's one of the founders, I guess, of No Brainz Productions, right? Mm-hmm. He's a singer, a musician, an actor. He's got it all. His name is Greg Paul, and I'm so happy to have you on the show.
It's my pleasure. Thank you. Wow. Really appreciate it.
Yeah, I think the first time I met you, I think, was through JT, obviously. But
right.
But I think it might have been either at a JT gathering or at an audition where we might have met.
Which wouldn't surprise me at all, right. Because you, aside, you're a fine actor yourself.
Thank you so much. You know. So. How long, JT is really the connection that we have here.
Yeah.
How long have you known JT?
Since 2010.
Wow.
Yeah. I literally connected with him shortly after I was in town,
right.
and he got me onto Vinny, the late, great Vinny Vella, got right. me onto his show there in Manhattan Cable Network, and I've been working on and off with JT for, a good 10 years.
Yeah, he's a good guy. And we wish him well, right?
Absolutely. I hope he feels better.
So you're originally from California.
Originally from California, Southern California.
And what'd you do there? I'm just curious.
This is where right. it gets interesting.
Yes.
I actually started in the music business.
Right.
And worked for a lot of the Warner Electra Silomax. I won't name drop. Right. A lot of people. If I say the house band at Gazzari's in 1974, right. you would know that that would be Van Halen.
Right.
All right. So these guys were all friends of ours or friends of mine because I know you spent some time in Hollywood right around that same time.
Right.
And I know we went to a party together
we
at some
to.
Point,
right.
you know, 45 years ago, 50
right.
years ago.
Right.
Had to. Just right. had to, because it was too small of a community. So I grew up in the music community and was actually, had been doing that. I was a professional musician and toured either as a sound reinforcement engineer or as a side musician. If I wasn't running main stage sound for them or front of house, then I would later tour with them as a background singer, percussionist, and worked with a bunch of West Coast Latin bands, Santana, Cold Blood, Tower of Power,
wow.
El Chicano, Malo, and then all your... Now I'm name dropping.
Right.
Sorry.
That's okay.
Yeah. So toured as a professional musician, did that for years. And then my son was born, ended up playing some music with a Boston Baked Blues. I was living finally ended up living in Boston.
Right.
And worked with a really great high-end wedding band on the Cape and Islands. They were right. the top band there. And I was doing that on weekends and running a chain of liquor stores. When a woman strolls in one day and she says, she's kind of eyeballing me. She comes in and she looks at me and I'm like, okay. And then she's grabbing stuff off the shelves and she keeps leaning over and looking and seeing, you know, what's going on. And I'm
right.
like, okay. Or maybe she just wants to get lucky. I don't know.
so
finally
know.
She comes to the counter and she says, and I said, can I help you? And she says, I'm a casting director and I'm out of Los Angeles and we're shooting a movie next week. Would you like to be in it?
Wow.
And I looked her in the eye and I said, honey, I don't do porn anymore. She says, oh, you're going to fit right in. You're going to fit right in.
That's
so next thing you know, I'm on a movie set and doing, that's a story in itself.
Right.
And then I started working in the movie business in Boston and working, you know, once a month, twice a month, three times a month, four times. Suddenly, I'm working all the time.
Right.
My boss finally calls me in. I had made them $1 million the previous summer.
Right.
She says, Greg, I have to fire you. The universe is trying to tell you something.
Right.
You should be doing that full time. You know, Adam Sandler doesn't call me at my house and ask me if I want to be in the next movie.
Right.
I don't drive cars with Tom Cruise.
Right.
You know, you're doing all these things that are happening for you, right. and it's a sign from the universe. So I'm going to give you your month's salary and pay your Cobra for a month.
So how do you feel when he let you live?
Well, she just kicked me out of a job that I had benefits and everything else.
Right.
I was
a kid. Right?
I was a homeowner. I had a son. You
right.
know, I mean, I was frankly, I was a little worried.
Right.
But within a week, yeah. I got in a call from a lady named Annie Mulhall, who runs the biggest casting agency in Rhode Island, and she oh. says, we had somebody come do 6 weeks of this particular pilot.
Right.
He can't do it anymore because that was all the vacation time he could use. We hired somebody that said he could do it, and he didn't last a week. If you'll commit to the next 3 months, you can have a job on the ABC series Body of Proof.
Oh, my God.
And I went to work for ABC Television on the biggest show in New England at that time, and the only ABC, you know, series that was shooting up there.
That's fantastic.
And after that, I had nowhere else to go. There was nothing in New England that could match that. Right. So the next move was New York.
Right.
So 2010, I arrived here.
So what happened to music when all this was happening?
I put that on the back burner. I'd been doing it for 30 years, steady, right, and touring and playing and doing all that stuff. And it wasn't, it didn't have the same feel for me anymore. I didn't feel that calling. And it was, if you weren't paying me, I didn't want to pick up a guitar.
Right. But for acting, it was different.
It was different. This was
is
suddenly,
it a rush for you?
Absolutely. Right. I mean, just being able to become another character, be somebody else. And of course, my first time out, I didn't know what I was doing.
Right.
It was just a question of, you know, I kept coming back and realizing, oh, well, then this is how it works. And then everybody would explain it. I'm like, interesting.
Well, it's interesting because how I started also is very similar to how you started. My start in Cagney and Lacey was purely because of my look. And because obviously you said the casting director was checking you out, mm-hmm, right? And just you do have a very distinctive look. And the thing you have that I don't have besides anything else is that you're tall. So the combination of all that stuff, I could see what she was looking at. But once you get the gigs, then you really have to really fine-tune the instrument.
Oh, yeah. Well, you get some training.
Right.
You go out and get the best teachers possible.
Right.
It's a serious job. It's
right.
an undertaking. And now that I was forced to do it full-time,
right,
it was like, I got to get good at this now.
Right.
I really need to perfect my craft. I
exactly.
really need to study. I really need to know what I'm doing.
Right.
So I took classes and you know, studied with teachers and,
right.
and did that type of thing. And I feel I have control over that. I have control over the instrument.
Right.
Now. I know what I'm doing. And I did this and tried to work as just an actor for the first 4 or 5 years I was here,
right,
and realized that it is extremely difficult.
Okay,
make a living.
Before we go to the next chapter,
sure,
maybe we could see some of the stuff. You brought a clip, you know? Let's share this clip of Greg Paul.
Okay.
It's just a few scenes, but still, you're a very interesting actor.
Thank you.
I really enjoy watching your stuff. So let's check it out.
If I had any intention of calling the authorities, you think I'd be sitting here with a corpse awaiting your blundering genius?
This makes me want to walk, man.
Oh, you're not going anywhere, son. And if you ever do, believe me, it'll be at a crawl, not a walk. What's it gonna be?
Where the hell do you think you're going?
Don't follow me, Harry. You're not gonna make me feel better.
Good. I don't know how you feel. I just want you to do your job.
I was doing my job. I just didn't think you were that type of person.
The logical kind. The kind that doesn't give a $1 billion project to a rookie fresh out of grad school.
The kind that fucks over the best person in the department in favor of some arrogant he plays golf with.
Tell me, Danny, are you currently employed?
Yes.
What are you doing?
I work at McDonald's.
McDonald's?
Yes, I realize that.
You know what that tells me? That tells me you work in the real world with real people. I bet you're fluent in Spanish by now.
That's great, you know, and I have to admit, I've seen you audition too, and yeah, and when I was a little bit weaker, I felt intimidated by you. I mean, you're really good, not just on the screen, but in person, and I do remember it, and I remember walking away saying, damn, I don't think I'm going to get the gig, because we were going for the same part. No, I'm serious. I remember even the location in my mind, and it was someplace in Queens, but I'm so happy we were able to, you know, meet in this environment because
yeah.
I got a chance actually to talk to you before the show. So you're an actor, but then you realize that there has to be something else in your life to get you to the next. I mean, you're right. It's a tough gig,
right,
especially in New York.
Right.
In the 80s, when I was in Hollywood, I mean, almost everything was always a highly paid gig. I mean,
mm-hmm,
you know, almost everything was SAG.
Right.
You know, you make some money. You can.
It's the exact opposite.
That's
now.
What I'm saying. Now it's the flip
side.
You
can't make a living. As a journeyman actor,
right,
you can't get, there are so many out of work,
right,
motion picture and television stars,
right,
that are literally, I went to an audition, I'm going in for a 5-line role on Power.
Right.
And I step out of the elevator and I look over, I see a guy stand, looks vaguely familiar. And so I go, you know, into the audition room, I sit down, I come back in, and I realize this guy had a series in the 80s.
Right, it's crazy.
He's reading for the same role, but his agent is sending him out because he needs to make his SAG payments.
Right.
He needs, you know, he needs to make it. He needs to make his residuals. He needs to make, you know, he needs
to
work.
He needs his health. You have to make money in order to get your health care.
Exactly. He has to get his health care. Well, this is the only reason why, you know, Ian Ziering took the job in Sharknado.
Right.
Because other than that, if he didn't take the gig, his family wouldn't have health insurance.
Right. And I remember even going back to the Hollywood days, I was auditioning for people that were on F Troop. You know, they'd come in for the same, you know, the same commercials or whatever I was working for. I couldn't believe it. You know, here's this kid from the Bronx at the time, you know, and going against people who, you know, they
need to resumes, huge resumes, and tons of experience, and it's just like, wow. You know.
So what was the next step for you?
Well, you realize that as an actor, you're just the hired help.
Right.
And you have no control. So the three people that control things on a set is the producer who hires everybody,
right.
The director who runs the circus,
right.
And the writer. Because they both turn to him and go, what happens next?
Right.
So I didn't have the money to be a producer. working 10 years to be on the director's track, working away from second AD to first AD, right. and trying to convince somebody to let
time.
You, that's also a tough road to hoe.
Right.
So the writer thing was something, I've been a professional storyteller and musician and songwriter for 40 years.
Right.
That was a tool I already had. I could make you cry in 3.5 minutes.
Right.
You give me an hour to do that stuff, I got that.
Right.
So I went back to school, did 4 years, got my master's just a couple years back.
That's great.
In screenwriting.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Yes.
You're never too old to learn. You're
That's
never
true.
Too old to tighten up your craft.
Right.
You're never too old to learn something new.
Right.
You have to challenge yourself daily,
right.
Or you're not growing. If you're not uncomfortable, you're not growing.
Do you get the same buzz from what you're doing now? That
absolutely. Really knowing how to craft a story,
right.
and make it happen,
right.
And affect people emotionally, because
yeah.
you know how to. I know how to do that now.
Right.
Before it was kind of a mystery. I didn't really understand exactly what it was I was trying to accomplish.
Right.
Now that I've had it pointed out to me,
right.
I'm like, I can do this.
And the way you can tell you can do this is that you can have unbelievable actors reading the words that you've created.
Right.
And I know you have. I mean, could you tell us about some of the things?
Well, we work with a producer who, you know, Steve Daniels.
Right.
So I started work with Steve on a project called The Fifth Borough,
right.
And did a pitch package,
right.
Or your lookbook. And
right.
It was pitching to NBC
right.
Universal.
Right.
The pitch package was good. They
right.
they said, great, we want to bring this in. And so it kind of went through development hell.
Right.
You know, we went to TNT for 3 months. We went to AMC, and then we went over to one of their other channels.
Right.
But it was in turnaround for about a year.
Right.
And then they said, well, we just can't seem to find the right fit. And they gave it back to Steve, and Steve said, well, I was going to shoot it as a feature anyway.
Wow.
So he's done that. That comes out January 17th, by the way. It's going to be headlining at the Hell's Kitchen Film Festival.
Oh, that's awesome.
So right. Now I don't have as much to do with that,
right.
Because that was Steve and John and maybe another writer, which the first thing is you discover as a screenwriter is that you will be rewritten.
Right.
That, you know, if the producer has a different thing or they want to make some changes, they're going to bring in somebody else. They're
right.
going to bring in a friend of theirs, and you
but you're the person
don't necessarily get credit.
You were the person who actually started the ball rolling with that one.
Well, yeah, it was Steve's concept
right.
and idea, and John Bianco, who was his director at the time. And so he came to me with the treatment.
Right.
And then I fleshed that out, put it into 12, 13 episodes, put
right.
a book together.
And you've developed a relationship. And then
oh,
you
yeah. And I introduced him to my friend, Derek.
Right.
Derek McKay, who's
right.
my partner at No Brainz.
Right.
Derek
and
has
Brainz
written.
Is what?
No Brainz is our production company. We are a joint American, Canadian, and Mexican film production,
right.
film and television production, and distribution company.
And when did you guys put that together?
We put that together and are firing on all cylinders this year,
oh,
2020. This is the year we just,
this is great.
This is the when we do it, you know.
Well, that's really,
we pulled the trigger and on January 5th, when everybody was doing a full week's worth of business.
Right.
So I had a gentleman from Paris call me. This is Pierre, I'm from Sinando. And Sinando, if you're not familiar, is an international aggregate site, a website for worldwide.
Yes.
All your filmmakers, distributors, production companies, et cetera, et cetera.
Right.
So when you are listed on this site, and then you are officially registered, listed, you are a film production and distribution entity.
That's awesome. Congratulations.
Thank you.
So so what's the future? Do you think that it'll be released? I'm curious about The Fifth Borough. I know that.
Oh, yeah. Steve has already got that, I'm sure, lined up for... you know, streamer release. So he has deals in place for the two features already that Derek has written for him. Because Derek wrote Clinton Road, which came out last year.
Right.
And he wrote Hinton House, which just came out, just released, I think, right at the end of this year, or the end of last year, December. We're 2 weeks into January?
Right. So, yeah. so with your new production company.
Yes.
How do you do the writing, or do you get writers?
We're both involved with the writing because we're both, you know, professional screenwriters. Right. So of course story is key.
But do you get stories from other people too that you can
produce?
We
look at stories from other people, absolutely. Right. I mean, we're open. We work with a group called Screenwriters, Screenwriting You.
Right.
Who have turned out some fantastic talent. There's a lot of things in development right now that are all Screenwriting U alumni. Right. These are all friends of ours. We both went to Screenwriting U. That's where we met.
Right.
We were critiquing each other's work and doing different classes together, and we hit it off. We had a similar style, so we agreed to work together and just haven't stopped.
And how about, and it's an international company that you put together, correct?
Right.
So do you get writers from other countries that also...
Yeah, well, we'll be working with a lot of Latin stars.
Right.
The first movie they're shooting is going to be down in Mexico.
Right.
And we're scheduled to go down there in March. I have a meeting in 2 weeks. I'm going down and meeting with the head of the Film Institute to pave the way.
That's great.
At the end of January here. And then in March, we'll be shooting a trailer down there. We're using some young talent from different telenovelas, different Latin-based television shows. In fact, there's one that's called Telehits, which is the Mexican equivalent of VH1 or MTV.
That's great.
So these VJs introduce musical talent in Latin America, and they're all young, good-looking guys and girls.
Right.
And we're going to be using them to be the stars of our movie.
And, I mean, Spanish-speaking people in the world, how many are there?
We got a lot. There's a lot.
I mean, it's all over. And novellas, I mean... So what type of projects are you looking specifically for, any type of projects, or is it just a matter of... if it's a good quality.
It's got to be a quality project. Right. Right now, we have three projects in the pipeline. Right. The first one that we're doing is a very specific genre movie. We're doing a zombie movie.
Oh, cool.
That's
great.
We're using the Blumhouse model, which Jason Blum has, he makes they're low budget.
Right.
They're a million or less.
Right.
So they're low budget, but with a high return.
You could do a lot with $1 million.
You absolutely can. Okay. And we can do a lot with half that.
Right.
So, and we're going to.
Right.
And then spend the rest of the budget on advertising, because if you make a great movie, people have to know that they can go and see it.
Well, talking about master's degrees, I got my MBA, and what I did was basically looked at, you know, what happens to films, you know, if you don't put the promotional money in, or at the right time, or if you put promotional money in for films that aren't good, you know, basically it's the abandonment option that I did it. But one of the things you do find is that when, you know, for a good project, you better invest in the promotion. I mean, or else
you've got to have P&A.
Got
to have P&A, which is publicity and advertising.
Right.
And the other half is that we're hiring these guys and girls specifically because they have huge social media followings.
Right.
Which is going to help us tremendously down there. They will start tweeting
that's
and put that out.
That's what it's all about now. Yeah.
And then we'll just follow up on that buzz.
Well, that's it. I guess it's word of mouth, but beyond that. I mean, that's word of mouth on steroids is social media.
Yeah, so we have a really solid business model of how we're going to accomplish this goal. Oh. And we're not trying to step into the States at this point. We're going to work overseas. We're going to work in another country and make it happen there first.
So how did you meet your partner?
Online. I mean, we were basically in the same classes. Screenwriting U is a fantastic program. If you want to learn how to screenwrite, I highly recommend it.
Right.
Hal Crossman really has a specific expert model to turn you into a working screenwriter.
So who made the first move in terms of to get together? I mean, I'm always interested on how partners become partners, you know, because it's a tough thing because, you know, when you're a partner with someone, you have to really trust them and really, you know,
We had both, because we were taking the same classes and swapping notes, then we started doing this stuff online with Google Docs.
Oh, interesting.
Where you get on the same doc and you start, so you're literally typing and doing it
at the same time.
Right. And we're having so much fun.
Right.
You know, I'm correcting the spelling, or I'm doing this, or I'm doing, and he comes up with some great ideas, and then we elevate them. I take them to the next level, or I'll suggest something.
Where is he from?
That's genius. He's Canadian.
Canadian, interesting. You know, that opens up a whole new universe for you.
Right.
And United States opens up a whole new universe for him.
Right.
So it's unbelievable. It's amazing what the internet, you know, whatever, you know, the World Wide Web.
Right. And of course, we met in person. He came up, and we spent the day. We went out. We took the girlfriend and went to, you know, Coney Island, and hung out and just had a great time and really hit it off. And so we've just, you know, stayed in touch and done this. He's been working for Steve long distance because he currently lives in Mexico.
Wow.
Which is why another reason why we're going to be shooting in Mexico.
Cool.
So because I've been going down for the last couple of years, and it's been 6 months out of the year down there. So I've made a lot of really great connections. There's a lot of places, and we can shoot down there for unbelievably inexpensive.
It's not New York prices.
It's not New York prices. Right. So, you know we can get this accomplished and get it done for the kind of money that we have to work with
that's
for our
so
first
great.
Project out.
You seem so excited. I mean, that's what it's all about, though. I mean, it gets your blood, going, and it's fantastic.
Yeah.
It's that same, it's, again, like the actor rush, but it's all...
You're working, you're accomplishing something,
right.
and it's concrete. It's something you physically, you're working on, on a daily basis.
Right.
Every day there's some other gift coming in,
right.
or you've got to accomplish something. There's something on that goal, and we're working towards this particular goal.
And you're
but
totally
there's a
focused
series
on
of
it
steps.
Right now. I mean, this is the...
Well,
is
it, yeah, I mean...
Are there other things that you're focused on?
Well, I have a day gig.
Okay.
You know, I mean, I'm currently working. I'm a customer experience ambassador at Hudson Yards.
Oh, I didn't know that.
So, I'm out there interacting with people. I set up tours. I do restaurant reservations. I mean, you deal with groups on a regular basis, and you deal with the public.
Right.
So, I love it. It's so much fun.
And you have so much energy that it's...
So
and you're a people person.
I make it fun, and like I said, I'm getting paid to have a good time,
right.
Which, is, yes, I'm going to take your money, but,
right.
I feel a little bit bad doing it.
Do you ever go back to Hollywood or New York? I mean, to California?
I was just in Cali in San Diego and went down there to meet my son, see my sister. My sister had her birthday out
there. Oh, your son lives out there?
Yeah, he's studying psychology.
Oh, cool.
And getting ready to help PTSD vets. He just did a stretch. He did 10 years in the Marine Corps.
Wow.
He just got out. He's going to do another 10 in the reserves, and then he'll get out with a full 20 pension. But in the meantime, he's using his GI Bill to do a psychology so he can help PTSD vets.
Well, that's God's work.
And this came out of the blue for me. And when he told me what he was doing, I was proud enough when he joined the Marines.
Right.
But this makes me even more proud.
I mean, that's a blessing to have a child like that.
I'm thankful I just didn't screw him up too bad. So,
we try our best not to, but somewhere, I don't know. I was screwed up by my parents, so I'm sure I screwed up my
kids. We were all screwed up by our parents, but somehow some of us got over it.
I mean,
you just keep pushing forward.
So I'm excited for you. I mean, I can't wait to retire from my gig so I could start doing new things again. I do feel a little bit constrained in my life because I'm still like working a gig that like at least 40 to 50 hours a week plus, going downtown. It's difficult for me to do that. I mean, I guess you're doing that also though, right?
Right. You make the time for the things that are important to you. And it's not that like I skimp on the day. I show up, I'm there every day,
Is it an 8-hour gig?
8 to 10.
Wow.
But... Again, you're around wonderful people. So
when do you write, usually?
When I go home at night.
Really?
And I put time aside to do that. I either do it in the morning when I'm working. If I don't go until noon, I'll write a couple hours in the morning.
A few hours a day, is that how you do it?
Minimum.
You're
right,
it's
a discipline. So you need to make time. And you learn the value of an outline.
Right.
You don't just let your characters run away with the story. An outline will save you.
Right.
The power of the outline is something I cannot tell you enough because
right.
what you have to know where it's going.
Right.
And then that frees you up to work within that.
Right.
You know where it's going to end.
You got the barriers.
You know where it's going to start and you know where it's going to end.
Right.
And so you can go anywhere in between that spot.
Right.
So that's hugely important and it's very freeing
right.
once you know, because you know you're working towards a certain point.
Right.
And it's not cliche. You're not locked into that. It can change.
Right.
Your goal can change at the end. And if it does, because you've elevated it, use it.
So I have a question, because when I was in Hollywood, the script lady, who usually was a female, would be there. And if you said a the instead of an or if you said if, or whatever, even small words, they would stop and you'd have to actually say the right word, especially on Cagney and Lacey. So is that still something that's going on at this point, or is there more leeway with words?
On television, the writers are king.
Right.
In the movies, it's quite different because in other words, the producer is king. The producer can get changes because of budget and things like that. He will rewrite a script constantly.
So it's different than TV.
It's different than television. Right. Movies are different than TV. Absolutely. Right. There's a lot more freedom in films than there is in television.
See, I never realized that. That's interesting. But I do remember that they'd have to call a bunch of people if they wanted to change a line or if they gave someone a line.
Right. On television, they really run a much tighter
ship. It's probably because of the...
Because of the time constraints. Right. They need to get it done. They have to get so much... They can't take longer.
Especially if it's like an hour show
days.
Or something like that. I
mean, they've only got X amount of time to get... They've got 7 to 8 days to get that entire
episode
done.
We had an eight-day turnaround for Cagney and Lacey. Yeah. That was 48 minutes plus commercial time.
Mm-hmm. And nobody screws around. You got to get it done, and you got to get it done right.
Well, and sometimes you have 16-hour days to get it done right.
Exactly.
Right. Yeah. So I miss those. I'll tell you, I miss being young and being able to work for 16 hours.
Who doesn't?
Right? But you might find yourself in that situation again.
I'm working on a showrunner. I'm pitching a sci-fi series. Yeah.
Right. So do you think you still have the energy to do those 16-hour days?
And Yeah. That you know, I'm just trying to stay healthy,
right.
Work out, eat right, everything in moderation.
Right.
You know.
It's just the opposite of when we were young, right?
When we were young, we thought
That's it, you live forever. You
I thought I was going to, you know, live till I'm 30, die, leave a good-looking corpse. You know, I'm
That's
it. I'm gonna go the distance, you know. Like I said, well, your father's 104?
104.
My dad just died at 94.
Right.
So we're gonna lead long, healthy lives.
Yeah, but my father retired at 62.
Wow.
No, you know. But he still lived a long life. And after my mother passed away, he had a couple of girlfriends in his 90s.
Sure.
You know, so right now he's getting a little old. You know, he's gonna be 105 in March.
Right.
And he did this show about 80 times. I used to bring him on this show.
Right.
And it was just the
I know, I caught a couple episodes.
Wonderful. You know, I love this show. Because I get an opportunity to meet people like you who I've seen in the background because never really stepping up and communicating with and finding out fascinating things. I mean, I think your life is starting over again. I mean, how many different lifetimes have you had, you know?
Three or four, you know, and everybody's, you're reinventing yourself again. Well, you know, if like I said, if you're not challenging yourself, if you're not pushing yourself to... you know, a new limit. If you're not uncomfortable, you're not growing.
Right.
And growth is something we can all use. I try not to be stagnant. I try and learn something new every day.
Right. And you actually don't seem to have aged since the last time I saw you. So actually, you look almost in better shape now than...
I am.
Right.
I've just recently dropped about 10, 15 pounds.
You look great, man.
I'm just trying to be the best I can because I know what's coming down the road.
Right.
I'm setting myself up to... work really hard.
And I know what's coming down the road. I have just one thing left to say. That's a wrap. Good night, folks.